Okay. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى ال سيدنا محمد كما تحب وترضى من تصلي عليه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم in terms of سوره الكهف itself is the 18th سوره of the Holy Quran. Now in terms of the historic occasion of revelation, right, it deals with an era when the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Makkah al-Mukarramah. So this is a Makkah surah, it's a surah, Makki surah, right? And it was revealed just before, according to most of the exegetes, it was revealed before the Muslims went to Abyssinia, meaning they migrated to Abyssinia. So it must have been about plus minus 8 or so years, right, after the Holy Prophet ﷺ officially announced and declared his Nubuwwah, that Suratul Kahf was revealed. Now, we have to look at the conditions in Makkatul Mukarramah at that time in order for you to understand the context of Suratul Kahf. One is that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers were increasing day by day, in spite of the fact that you had endless persecution upon the followers of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. By that time, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had undergone, right, a boycott, right, in Sha'bah Abi Talib, and so on. There, he had lost his wife Khadijah al-Kubra radiallahu ta'ala and his uncle Abu Talib, right, in that period of time as well. And this was just before. This was just before that. That was before that. And the Holy Prophet ﷺ had to endure a whole lot of oppression and things, but his numbers were growing. Now the Kuffar of Makkah, in spite of the fact that they were proficient in business, Makkah was the center of trade. Makkah was the financial capital of the Middle East at that time. Right? All the businessmen, the bankers in particular, were found in Makkah. Right? Medina had an agrarian community. You know, there were farmers, date palms, this and that and whatever it is. The people of Makkah had the cash. They couldn't grow anything in Makkah because Makkah is arid land, right? It's desert land. Right? But they had the money because they were in charge of the Holy Kaaba. So people used to come for pilgrimage to the Holy Kaaba and they were in charge of giving them water and accommodation and putting them up and whatever it is. So it became a good market for trade as well. And because these people were taking care, the Kuffar of Makkah were taking care of the pilgrims and whatever it is, they amassed quite a bit of capital. And they used to have markets, or they had, you know, like market fairs, and you know, these trade fairs, like in Ukaz and all of these places, they used to have these trade fairs. So when people used to come for Hajj, it also used to be a trade and expo, you know, exhibition they used to have there, you know, for your goods and whatever it is. So the people of Makkah used to pool their monies together, and they would go out in caravans to Syria, to Yemen, here, there, you know, لِإِلَا فِي فُرَيْشٍ إِلَا فِي مْرِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالسَّيْءٍ. So in the autumns and so on, they used to go to another area. In the summer months, they used to go to the cooler areas. So they would engage in trade all the time, the Quraysh. Right? Now, in that period of time, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these people are steeped in idol worship. They don't know any better. They've never received a revelation, or they haven't had a prophet amongst the Arabs. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was born and brought up amongst them, comes with a revolutionary message. Now, in spite of the fact that because of their power, because of their wealth, because of their influence, initially they were successful, right, in thwarting some of the efforts of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the truth of the message of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could not in any way be diminished. It's not going to happen. It's out of the question. It was inevitable that Islam will prevail. And you know the history, the Prophet called all of them, and Abu Lahab cursed the Prophet, Tabbat Yada, Abi Lahab, etc., etc., etc. Now in the interim, what they decide is, hey, hold on a minute, we are a bunch of unpar jahils, right, in terms of religion. But Medina, Al-Madina, that was called Yathrib at that time, it was about 380 odd kilometers away. Although it's not much of a distance now, in that time there, it was almost like a different country. But in Medina, there was a different scenario. In Medina, there were Yahudis, the Jews. And they had established themselves there almost for about 400 years, right? You know the history, some of it there, that there was a king from Yemen, right, who came to Al-Madinah al-Munawwara, and he had within his Jewish scholars and, you know, and so on there, who informed him that this is the city of the birth of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and his name was Tubba, right? He told them, they said, look, you carry on, we want to live here, because if the Prophet of Allah comes, then we want to meet him, because these are the signs of the place of his final resting place and his messengership and whatever it is. So the Tubba said, who is this Prophet of Allah, etc., etc., and they informed him in detail. I'll give you the details some other day. Right? He got these people married to the people around that area. He built up almost 400 homes, and he actually founded what we know today as the city of Al-Madinah al-Munawwarah. And these people, by successive generation, lived there and waited for the arrival of the Prophet of Allah. And by that time, because they were from a Jewish background, right, Judaism had established itself in Medina. And the economy in Medina was also controlled by the Jews. So the city of Medina, in spite of the fact that it had mushriks, polytheists, and whatever it is there, right, it still had a very dominant monotheistic Abrahamic culture. Now the kuffar of Mecca have never dealt with the person who's claiming revelation. I receive revelation from God. And he says, I'm receiving scripture, I'm receiving Quran. And I'm testifying to that which is already in the Torah and in the Injil. So the people of Mecca realized, they said, you know what? We need to do something about this man. So because they had some contact with the people of Medina who used to come there to Mecca for pilgrimage and whatever it is there, they sent a delegation of people to Makkah al-Mukarramah. Now, Imam Ibn Hisham, Imam Abdul Malik bin Hisham, right? In his Sirat Ibn Hisham, he gives this reason for the occasion of revelation of Surah Al-Kahf. And he said, the Kufar of Makkah said, Al-Nadhr bin Ibn Harith and Uqba bin Abi Mu'ayt. Uqba bin Abi Mu'ayt was one of the people that used to actually try to throttle the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what do you call it? What's the word? Exfixiation, what's it? Suffocate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? What he should do, he should take out the entrails of the animals, right? You know, like that bag that you get, you know, they take out all the yucky stuff from inside there. He would take that and place it over the face of the Prophet Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? Can you imagine? I mean, you see the thing right? Besides the stink, because that's, you know, that all that muck is inside there, he would take it and place it over the Prophet so that it would suffocate him because he can't breathe inside there. Uqba bin Abi Mu'ayt was one of those people. So they sent Nazar bin Ibn al-Hazm and Uqba bin Abi Mu'ayt to the ulama of the Yahud in Medina. Now remember, the ulama of Yahud in Medina, they were very, very, very well versed, right? Abdullah bin Salam and all of, he was the chief rabbi. So they came to the people of Medina and said, look, this is a man who's claiming that he's a prophet of God. So they had a meeting with all the ulama there. So the ulama heard them and said, okay. They heard some, he said, we've heard some stories, but tell us more about him and explain. He said, okay, there's a way for you to be able to figure out whether he's a true prophet or whether he's an imposter. Last week, for those guys who missed out tough, I discussed quite a few of the other questions that were posed by the Jews on numerous other occasions, right? And there were some very interesting questions as well, and the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied to it. So anyway, Nazar ibn al-Haris and Uqba bin Abi Mu'ayt come to the Yahudi scholar and say, look here, tell us now whether this man is genuine or not, because he's now become a threat to our way of life, to our ideology, to our deen that we subscribe to. So the Yahudi ulama got together and said, well, what are we going to do about it? They said, okay, there's it here. Ask him three questions. In one narration, they say that ask him three questions. If he can't answer any of the three questions, he's an imposter. Right? If he answers two out of three, then he's a prophet. Right? And if he answers all three, then he must be one of these madmen, or he must be one of these guys who knows the occult, or you know, that type of thing there, and he gets stories from the jinn and whatever it is. That's one narration, but the stronger narration is that pose him three questions. The first question, right, you must ask him about that group of people, right, who, the young people there, who went into a cave and went into seclusion. What happened to them? Ashabul Kahf. The first question that the Jews asked was about Ashabul Kahf, right? About the young boys who went and secluded themselves in a cave. What happened to them? And they said, if he's a prophet of Allah, he'll be able to give you an answer. Then they posed the second question. He said, going to ask him about a man who traveled the east and the west, right? And about his, you know, interactions with the people of the west, right? And what was the occasion and what were the issues that they dealt with and they discussed with in this man's life. And the third question was about, ask him about the ruh. Ask him about the soul. And it's a very interesting thing. These were not stupid people. One question, right, is historical. Right? The second question is to a certain degree historical, but he's also mystical, right? And the third question is purely spiritual. In fact, the Zulqarnain's one is not only historical in terms of past, but is historical in terms of future. Because the story of Dhul Qarnayn has to do with Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Gog and Magog, as Mr. Imam Hussein would say. Right? Ya'juj and Ma'juj. So from the perspective of historical, it means you need to know history of what happened in the past, as well as history which is still to occur in the future. And who truly the Dhul Qarnayn is. Now sometimes people say Dhul Qarnayn was Alexander the Great. No, that's generally the false tafsir they give up. Or some people say it was Attila the Hun. Why? Because you know the Vikings had two horns. Dhul Qarnayn, the man of two horns. So Vikings had two horns. Right. Interesting that you say Attila the Hun. There is a historical narrative that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, one day he got up and in Sahih Muslim, he said, Waylul lil Arab. Right? He said, woe unto the Arab. Today, a hole this size has been made in the wall which separates Ya'juj and Ma'juj. I'm giving you the gist of the hadith. I can't remember the exact words of the hadith. Right? You can look it up. Right? And when they mentioned that day, historians went and figured out basically what was the time. And it was at that time they were Attila the Hun. You know, the guy, I think he was from Germany or somewhere there. Right? He had reared his ugly head. Right. So anyway, we'll discuss that at a later stage. Don't stress about that right now. So Ya'juj and Dhul Qarnayn story has to do with history, with past, as well as future, the end of times, right, and beginnings of times, so to speak, right. And then Ashabul Kahf has to do with something which is completely mystical, right? Because Am hasibta anna Ashabul Kahf wa Rahim kanu min ayatina ajaba. They are unique signs, ajab, ajib, strange, unique signs about Ashabul Kahf. And then the third question, was alunak anir ruh, right, is now purely spiritual. What is the ruh? And the Jews had to have had a lot of knowledge and had something there which would perplex them, right, in terms of what is the ruh. So these were the three questions that were posed. So when Nadar ibn al-Haris and Uqba bin Abi Mu'ayth came back to Makkah al-Mukarramah, they came to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Now, here's another twist in the tale. They came back to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they posed the three questions to him. Now, they already had an idea, right? Either three out of three, or two out of three, or none out of three. If it's one out of the question, if it's full three, dicey. But if it's two out of three, it's fine. Right? Now, but as I said, the stronger one is all three questions. The Prophet ﷺ said, no problem. The Prophet ﷺ was confident that inshallah ta'ala Allah will send down wahi to him. So he said, come to me tomorrow, right? And I will inform you. So the next day, all these guys come back now because they need to report to the Jews to say, look at this man, Rasulullah ﷺ has answered this question. So they come back and they ask the Prophet of Allah, give us answers. The Prophet of Allah says, wahi hasn't come. Wahi hasn't come. One day goes by. 2 days goes by, 3 days goes by, a week goes by, 10 days go by, Jibreel hasn't even come. You know, normally Jibreel will come. Now, can you imagine the Prophet of Allah, right, after all of that torture, after all that oppression, after all that the Kufar of Makkah said, now, when it comes to the Jews posing this question here, the Prophet of Allah is not receiving any wahi revelation. Can you imagine what the condition must have been in Makkah? Why did the Prophet ﷺ not receive revelation? Wisdom in it is multifold. Two or three things. One is, if the Prophet of Allah ﷺ, Allah deliberately in his infinite wisdom, deliberately made the Prophet ﷺ omit to say, Insha'Allah. وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ. It's in Surah Al-Kahf. إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ Allah. Right? But what's the wisdom behind the Prophet having omitted? Allah made him omit say inshallah. Can anyone give me an idea why the Prophet ﷺ's infinite wisdom was forgot, so to speak, to say inshallah? What does it symbolize?
A lesson to us.
No, besides the lesson to us, I want something historical. Come on. One chocolate clear for anyone who gets it right. Okay, never mind. Two. If you really get it, I'll give you a fuzza as well. Come on. Adila, you should be able to answer this at the very least. Otherwise, I'm going to phone up Sheikh Fahim and tell him about you. I'm going to start eating chocolate eclairs. Anyone know the story of Ya'juj and Ma'juj? What did they do? every single day? I see the pretty girl in the pink day. Give me an answer. Give me an answer. Don't feel shy. Don't worry. There's no such thing as a wrong answer. Exactly. Pass it on. Every day, Ya'juj and Ma'juj, the nations of Ya'juj and Ma'juj, every day they try to bring down that wall, which will then enable them to escape and wreak havoc. Okay? And every day they almost break it, and then the guy says, we broke it enough, we'll finish the rest off tomorrow. And they don't say? Can you see wisdom of Quran now? So the Prophet of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us two things. No good can happen except with the will of Allah. And no evil can even happen either except by the will of Allah. Because it's all in His mighty will. It's all His plan. Okay? So the Prophet of Allah, this is an ishara. This is an ishara in this year that the Prophet of Allah said, no, I'll tell you tomorrow. So the Prophet of Allah was informed, and these are the very other lessons like Sakina said as well. One is, that you've got to, now let me give you the most important lesson. The Prophet, Allah wanted to show to the kuffar of Makkah and to the Yahudis of Medina, it's being delayed. If the Prophet of Allah was, na'udhu billah, a soothsayer, right? Or if he was a person who was involved in the occult, or if he was a person there who was, you know, who was, na'udhu billah, majtoon, as the Quran, the kuffar used to say, or he was a sha'ir, or he was coming up with his own story and making his own stories there, he would have given an answer immediately. Or the next day he could have, you know, made up one story that this is like this here, and, because this requires detail. You got to tell people about a young group of people there who have secluded themselves. Now you can't make up a story about that. Right? And in terms of Dhul Qarnayn, right, you've got to know history, you've got to know this thing. And if a man who's been never been exposed to any area beyond Makkah al-Mukarramah except one or two trips that he made there, he will never be able to have, you know, found out about the history of Dhul Qarnayn. And most importantly, the most difficult question which perplexed the Jews themselves was about the reality of the ruh, the reality of the soul. Is the soul, the ruh, and the nafs the same thing? Are they one and the same? Right? What is the ruh exactly? Is it a physical entity? Is it a creation? Or is it divine spark? What is it? So that was perplexing them. So the Holy Prophet ﷺ didn't give an answer. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches one thing there, that if the Prophet of Allah ﷺ was making this Quran up there, he won't put himself through that degree of embarrassment to say, no way, bhai. Imagine this kuffar to taunt him will come every day. Muhammad ﷺ, where's the answer? And then the whole Makkah will start speaking about it there, that he's not a prophet, he's not receiving any message, but Allah is putting, there's a prophet. Because he receives wahi from me. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ He says nothing of his own desire. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحِيٌ يُوحَىٰ Whatever he says, right, is wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on like this, and after 15 days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the revelation. And according to the Mufassirun, right, Suratul Kahf in particular was revealed all at once. Don't worry about them, let them enjoy themselves, it's fine. Don't stress, it's fine. Right? After 15 days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down Jibreel Amin alayhi salatu wasalam, and Suratul Kahf was revealed. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then went on to give the answers. Now the interesting point is that وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ is not in Surah Al-Kahf. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي The Prophet of Allah answered the questions of Ashab Al-Kahf. Allah answered it in detail. Right? Dhul Qarnayn, Allah answered it in detail. The last one, the Prophet of Allah said, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ And they ask you, O Prophet of Allah, about the ruh. Right? Now, hold on. Quran speaks about, Allah answers the question of Dhul Qarnayn, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ ذِي الْقَرْنَيْنِ Allah said, they asked you about Dhul Qarnayn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ And they ask you about the ruh. But when it came to Ashab al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just started off with the discussion. أَمْ حَسِبَتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا As if, you know, this is the revelation from Allah, and Allah is giving you the story, and He commences the story with Suratul Kahf. So, Suratul وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْرُوحِ is not in Suratul Kahf, it's in Surah Bani Israel, the surah before Suratul Kahf. Why is that? That's a homework for next week, right? Homework for next week. You don't smile. If you've done, the Yajuj and Majuj course, they don't smile. Okay?
This reveal this order, Surah Maryam and then Surah Kahf.
No, Surah Bani Sa'id. I'm coming to the answer right now. I'll give you one of the reasons why, according to the scholars, right, the ruh, the question of the ruh was placed in Surah Bani Israel or Surah Al-Isra as opposed to Surah Al-Kahf, because it all was came down at once. The reason for this is that in terms of the tartib of the Holy Quran, the Quran has a certain sequence. It's not a necessarily a rhyming sequence, but if you look at Surah Al-Kahf, كانوا من آياتنا عجبا إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. If you look at the last words of each verse, you will see they have a rhyming scheme to it. من أمرنا رشدا فضربنا على آثارهم في الكهف سنين عددا. Can you see? رشدا. Right? كانوا من آياتنا عجبا. Right? Now, if you look at the at Surah Al-Wayas'alunaka 'an Dhalqayn Qul sa'atlu 'alaykum minhu dhikra inna makkanna lahu fil ardi wa atainahu min kulli shay'in sababa fa'atba'a sababa. Can you see a general? But if you look at Wayas'alunaka 'an ar-ruh, and if you look at the uslub of the bayan of Surah Bani Israel in terms of the rhyming sequence of the last words of those verses, وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا وَإِذَا أَنْعَمْنَا عَلَى الْإِنْسَانِ أَعْرَضَ وَنَأَى بِجَانِبِهِ وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ كَانَ يَئُوسًا قُلْ كُلٌّ يَعْمَلُ عَلَى شَاكِلَتِهِ فَرَبُّكُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ هُوَ أَهْدَى سَبِيلًا وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي وَمَا أُوتِيتُمْ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Can you see that?